Hi friends, may peace be upon you. This is the fifth part of Dental Promotric Exams, Solved MCQs. Welcome to Easy Learn. First question, GG number 1 file means A. 0.20 mm, B. 0.30 mm, C. 0.50 mm, D. 0.60 mm. Answer is C, 0.50 mm. Here is a brief description about Gates Glidden burrs. They have flame-shaped cutting point mounted on long thin shaft attached to a latch-type shank. Due to their designs, they are side-cutting instruments with safety tips. The flame-shaped head cuts laterally and is used with a gentle, apically directed pressure. It has a modified safe tip that is non-cutting tip. They are available in set 1 to 6 with diameters 0.5 to 1.5 mm. That is our question. GG1 is equal to 0.5 mm, GG2 0.7. GG3.9, GG4.1.1, GG5.1.3 and GG6.1.5 mm. Our question is GG1. It is 0.5 mm. Next question, use of bidwing radiograph all except A. caries detection, B. evaluation of periodontal condition, C. detect calculus, D. diagnosis of periapical lesions. Answer is D. diagnosis of periapical lesions. This film gets its name from the tab wing that the patient bites on to hold the film in place. This film shows crowns of both maxillary and mandibular teeth and portion of roots. They are used for the detection of interproximal caries and the contention of the alveolar bone. They are not used for the diagnosis of periapical lesions. So, our answer is option D. Next question. Best for maxillary sinus. A. Submento vertex. B. Waters view. C. Reverse Townes view. D. PA view. Answer is B. Waters view. Waters view, otherwise occipitomental view. Here, nose and chin touch the film and X-ray beam is projected from occipital side. It shows facial skeleton and maxillary antra and avoids superimposition of the dense bone of skull base. Indications are investigation of maxillary antra, detection of middle third fractures, coronoid process fractures, frontal and ethmoidal sinus orbital blowout. For memorizing Waters view for maxillary sinus, just look at the alphabets M and W. Just flip it out the alphabet M, it will become W. Memorize like that. Next question. After receiving one cartridge of local anesthetic, a healthy adult patient became unconscious in the dental chair. The occurrence of a brief convulsion is A. pathognomonic of grand mal epilepsy, B. consistent with a diagnosis of syncope, C. caused by the epinephrine in LA, D. pathognomonic of intravenous injection of LA. Answer is B. consistent with a diagnosis of syncope. A healthy patient who becomes unconscious after receiving an injection of a local anesthetic, especially if accompanied by brief convulsion, has almost surely had a psychogenic reaction to the injection experience. This anxiety reaction is syncope, which will be easily reversed. Here, the patient is healthy, therefore, the possibility of a grand mal epileptic seizure is unlikely. Epinephrine is not the cause of this type of reaction as it causes excitement and palpitations. It does not tend to cause convulsions or loss of consciousness. Intravascular injection of a single cartridge of local anesthetic is not likely to cause unconsciousness in a healthy adult patient
as the total quantity of anesthetic necessary would be more than is contained in a single cartridge.
Next question, which of the following is a buffering agent present in saliva? A. Urea, B. Proteins, C. Bicarbonate, D. All of the above. Answer is D. All of the above. Solutions containing both weak acids and their salts are referred to as buffering solutions. These solutions have capacity of resisting changes of pH where either acids or alkalis are added to them. The buffer capacity of saliva is regulated by three buffer systems, the carbonic acid bicarbonate system, phosphate system, the proteins, mucin. Additionally, ammonia and urea constituents of the saliva act as buffer. Next question, each of the following developmental seeds appears on radiographs except one. Which one? A. Nasolabial, B. Median palatal, C. Nasopalatine, D. Globulomaxillary. Answer is A. Nasolabial cyst. Nasolabial cyst is also called as nasoalveolar or Klestad cyst. A nasolabial cyst is a soft tissue cyst that does not involve the alveolus of maxilla, but it is usually described as a rare fissural cyst that may involve bone secondarily. Since there is no bony involvement, this cyst does not produce radiographically detectable changes. Clinical features include swelling over face in the nasolabial region, same swelling over floor of the nose. It is asymptomatic, unilateral nasal block is seen, pain occurs very rarely. The cyst should be surgically excised, although care must be exercised to prevent perforation and collapse of the lesions. They have asked the same question in a different way. Fissural cyst and entirely located on soft tissue. Here see the option B. Instead of nasolabial, they have given nasoalveolar. The options are globular maxillary, nasoalveolar, median alveolar and primordial cyst. Here the answer is B. Nasoalveolar cyst. Next question, ceramic shade matching is an important step in achieving natural aesthetics in dental tooth restoration. What is the most important dimension of color for dental restorations? A. Color, B. Hue, C. Value, D. Chroma, E. Metamerism. Answer is C. Value. So, value is the relative lightness or whiteness or darkness or blackness and brightness of color. From this picture, we get a clear idea about hue, value and chroma. Hue is the actual color. Hue, value and chroma are the three dimensions of the color. Chroma is the amount of saturation of the hue and value refers to the lightness or darkness of a color. It indicates the quantity of light reflected. Coming into dentistry, value differences are more noticeable and this may have significance in dental restorations than hue or chroma. Tooth with high value looks vital and tooth with low value looks grey. Which of the following is the most common site of squamous cell carcinoma of the oral cavity? A. Buccal mucosa, B. Floor of the mouth, C. Mandibular gingiva, D. Palate, E. Tongue. Answer is E. Tongue. The tongue is the most common site of squamous cell carcinoma of the oral cavity. Tongue carcinoma occurs most often in elderly persons but also seen in young adults and adolescents. The main cause of tongue carcinoma is due to excess consumption of alcohol and tobacco use. Approximately 36% of all squamous cell carcinoma of the oral cavity affect the tongue. The sites most likely to be affected by tongue carcinomas include anterior two-thirds, lateral borders and ventral surface of the tongue.
Approximately 33% of these tumors arise behind the circumvallate papillae. Because tongue carcinomas are typically painless, affected persons often do not seek treatment until the tumor becomes advanced and begins to ulcerate or cause pain or difficulties with speech or swallowing. Approximately 30% of all oral squamous cell carcinomas involve floor of the mouth. Approximately 16% involves mandibular gingiva, 10% buccal mucosa, only 3% involve palate.
Next question, when is an ANS appliance indicated? A. Bilateral loss of primary maxillary molars. B. Bilateral loss of primary mandibular molars. C. Loss of one primary molar. D. To control thumb sucking behavior. Answer is A. An ANS appliance is best used to maintain the space for bilateral loss of primary maxillary molars. A lingual holding arch is best used to maintain the space when bilateral primary mandibular molars are lost.
A distal shoe or band and loop can be used to maintain the space of one loss of primary molar. To control thumb sucking behavior, a crib should be used. So, ANS appliance for bilateral loss of primary maxillary molars.
I have given only the needed explanation for each question. If you want more explanation, please comment down. For part 1 to 4, see the description box. I will put the link. Please like, share and subscribe. Thank you for watching.